You know, guys, it's interesting when you think about there's two tensions going on here. One is, as Steve mentioned, this is a long form process. I mean, I can't think of any police department that was reformed in anything under 15 to 20 years. It's just a fact of, you know, of life. But folks want action now. They want to see something now and something on the ground that has tangible results. Kate, do you have a sense of if there's a way to reconcile those two things?
I think there is. I mean, one of the things that, you know, I am not a native New Mexican, but I've lived here for 16 years. And my experience in this community seems to be we like to do things. We think we have to start from scratch. And there are models out there. Mm-hmm. You know, right now we have the Memphis model with the CITs. And frankly, there's still some gaps in it. You know, one of the things to look at is focusing on the situations that Steve mentioned where the police do need to be called because of the potential for violence. But what about de-escalation techniques, improving those? They're supposed to be, according to the order and the implementation of it, they're supposed to be constantly looking at every incident and going back and learning from that and figuring out how to do it better, how to use less lethal means in those circumstances. So there is one focus thing we could do right now to make the CITs better. In addition, we could look at the models in these other communities like Denver and Eugene and elsewhere and say, what with our existing mental health services here, can we do maybe even in a pilot program to learn from these other communities? You have a bigger city like Denver who's just rolling it out. You have a smaller community like Eugene, Oregon. Why can't we look at that rather than creating a whole new department like Mayor Keller wants to do, particularly in a time where we have no budget and there's no state money? You know, we're suffering a recession from the pandemic. This isn't the time to me to start up a whole new thing. Maybe if we were flowing in money, but we're not. So mm-hmm. let's look at borrowing from what other communities have learned and applied successfully within our existing framework and finances to jumpstart some solutions here because mm-hmm. people are dying and we need right. that to stop. I mean, to tell you the truth, I was really ill earlier this year and I was very suicidal and I knew some of my friends were worried. And I was afraid to get that knock at the door from the police to somebody coming from a wellness check. And to be perfectly frank, I had PTSD about psych hospitals and I would not have gone willingly. And it could have gone south, right? Yeah. I mean, I may look like this isn't going to happen to me, but yeah, it could have. And I've had friends who've had those encounters. And one of the reasons the police are awkward for this is if you've ever had an encounter with a police officer or an involuntary commitment and being taken to the hospital, the ER, when you're in a mental health crisis, it's traumatizing. I have PTSD because of that. Yeah. So that's one of the reasons people amp up. That's why they escalate. If they've had that experience before, they're terrified and they're traumatized and they feel it's a life or death thing for them. And so, you know, I think we need to understand it more from the individual with the mental illnesses perspective, too. We have a voice here. It's not just the parents. It's not just the families. It's not just the clinicians. It's us. And I feel like we're left out of that. And we could be helpful in figuring out how to make progress now.
I appreciate those points. Kate, can I ask you actually a quick question about CIT crisis intervention training? Is there a way to explain that in 20 quick seconds, what's involved with that for the public? We hear this acronym a lot, but I feel like folks don't actually understand what goes on there.
Well, you know, I haven't been privy to the training, but the crisis intervention team is a mental health professional and a police officer. And they come and hopefully they're coming and not in a police vehicle with the lights blaring. Right. And the whole goal is to work together and the police officers get training in how to, you know, de-escalate situations, how to respond less violently, how to, when possible, put the social worker or the, you know, the mental health professional in the front. The mental health professional gets training in how to be aware of dangerous situations, respond to police direction if necessary. So it's kind of training them together. And within the program, if you go onto the city's website about the implementation of this order, there's language in the latest report that talks about how this is supposed to be an iterative process. So after every incident, they're supposed to look and see, should we have called the CIT? Should they have gone to the call? Did we utilize the CIT right? How did this escalate? What happened? How can we fix it? And it's supposed to be a constant learning curve. I have not seen any evidence of that in the public when after they have an incident, probably because they're worried about litigation. So you never see this. Right. I don't know if it's iterable. It should be because they don't talk about the individual. Yeah. So, and I think I'm going to file an iterable request pretty soon because I want to see if they've done this. because I think it's key to the learning, to the training, to changing the culture within APD.
Can I encourage you to kind of get on that and report back to us what you might
Absolutely.
Find?
Absolutely. I love filing it for requests.
Hey, I'm with you. It's a great leverage. Steve, you listening to Kate just now, how does that strike you as a parent? It was, you know, it's easy to go back and say, well, we wish this could have happened or that could have happened. But what Kate's describing hit your gut is the right way to go?
I do believe so. I certainly think so. And the key issue, she's mentioned it several times, is training.
Yeah.
Our officers have to receive the appropriate training on how to deal with people in crisis. We had one CIT officer come to our house early on, sat down with our son, and I cannot praise the gentleman enough. He was so calm. He was so quiet. He was so patient. He spoke to our son for a good 45 minutes before he and was able to persuade him. You know, hey, look, let's go on in. Let's get an evaluation. The other officers who came the day that my son was killed, there was no patience. There was no calmness. They escalated the situation right away. And there was only, there was, it, in less than 5 minutes, my son was dead. So, yes, I do agree. Training is critical, particularly for the CIT officers, but for all of the officers, so that they all have some knowledge on what to deal, on how to handle the situation, and when to call in for help when they need it.
Right, right. You know, I got a last question for Dr. Finney Coleman. And I'd like to ask the other folks for a little runway on this. When you consider African-American issues in our city, in our state, we're only 2.9% of the population statewide. The things we're talking about, is there special issues when it comes to people of color and Black people, particularly when it comes to dealing with APD? Is there something missing between APD's understanding of the community and maybe how we deal with them as well? What's your sense of that?
Yeah, my sense is, well, of course. There clearly is a disjunction between, you know, how communities of color are policed as opposed to communities that are more affluent. I mean, and that's just the way that it is, not just here in Albuquerque, it's across our country. And so when I look at it, I'm looking at it from a historical lens and the role that the police have always played in terms of the dominant culture and the military force available to that dominant culture to affect its will across communities. And so we can't divorce ourselves from that really dark. And so what policing means in communities that are more affluent is significantly different than what it means in communities, especially communities that are African-American, communities of color. For those communities, police officers are often seen as people who are there to surveil the community, to protect another community from that community.
Gotcha.
It's very difficult for us to divorce ourselves from that history. And as much as we might like to maybe, you know, pretend that is not the case here because we have, you know, a low percentage of the population being African-American, you know, close to 3%. But the truth is, this is something that's ingrained in the fabric of our nation. I think what we're seeing tonight, I guess it won't be tonight, it will be a couple of nights ago, in Louisville,
right,
with the Breonna Taylor case. Yeah. I mean, the kids who are in the streets are not in the streets because they're illogical and that their anger and frustration is misplaced. The police and their interaction with the in the Black community is coupled with a criminal justice system that has always been a system of privilege based on race. And so we're dealing with that in Albuquerque, just like every other community across this country. More work needs to be done in that area. We need to be intellectually honest about those interactions too.
Mm-hmm. Exactly right. Boy, guys, a lot to go on here. It's good stuff.